warm welcome to St Stephen Walbrook. I invite you to stand. Brothers and sisters in Christ, on this most holy eve, in which our Lord Jesus Christ passed over from death to life, the Church invites her members dispersed throughout the world to gather in vigil and prayer. For this is the Passover of the Lord, in which through word and sacrament we share in his victory over death. As we await the risen Christ, let us hear the record of God's saving deeds in history, recalling how he saved his people in ages past, and in the fullness of time sent his Son to be our Redeemer. Let us pray that through this Easter celebration, God may bring to perfection in each of us the saving work he has begun. Almighty Father, look with mercy on this your family, for which our Lord Jesus Christ was content to be betrayed and given up into the hands of sinners, and to suffer death upon the cross, who is alive and glorified with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Christ, yesterday and today, the beginning and the end, Alpha and Omega, all time belongs to him and all ages. To him be glory and power through every age and forever. Amen. As we celebrate the resurrection of our Lord Jesus Christ from the dead, we remember that through the Paschal mystery, we have died and been buried with him in baptism. To follow Christ means dying to sin and rising to new life with him. Therefore, I ask, do you reject the devil and all rebellion against God? Do you renounce the deceit and corruption of evil? Do you repent of the sins that separate us from God and neighbour? baptism, God calls us out of darkness into his marvellous light. Therefore, I ask, do you turn to Christ as Saviour? Do you submit to Christ as Lord? Do you come to Christ, the way, the truth, and the life? May Almighty God deliver you from the powers of darkness, restore in you the image of his glory, and lead you in the light and obedience of Christ. Amen.
The light of Christ. The light of Christ. The light of Christ.
Thank you. The Old Testament reading is taken from the book of Exodus, chapter 12. Then Moses called all the elders of Israel and said to them, "Go select lambs for your families and slaughter the Passover lamb. Take a bunch of hyssop, dip it in the blood that is in the basin, and touch the lintel and the two doorposts with the blood in the basin. None of you shall go outside the door of your house until morning. For the Lord will pass through to strike down the Egyptians. When he sees the blood on the lintel and on the two doorposts, the Lord will pass over that door and will not allow the destroyer to enter your houses to strike you down. You shall observe this rite as a perpetual ordinance for you and your children. When you come to the land that the Lord will give you, as he has promised, you shall keep this observance. And when your children ask, 'What do you mean by this observance?' you shall say, 'It is the Passover sacrifice to the Lord, for he passed over the houses of the Israelites in Egypt when he struck down the Egyptians, but spared our houses.'" And the people bowed down and worshipped. The Israelites went and did just as the Lord had commanded Moses and Aaron. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
The epistle is taken from St. Paul's letter to the Romans, chapter 6. "Do you not know that all of us who have been baptized into Christ Jesus were baptized into his death? Therefore, we have been buried with him by baptism into death, so that just as Christ was raised from the dead by the glory of the Father, so we too might walk in newness of life. For if we have been united with him in a death like his, we will certainly be united with him in a resurrection like his. We know that our old self was crucified with him so that the body of sin might be destroyed and we might no longer be enslaved to sin. For whoever has died is freed from sin. But if we have died with Christ, we believe that we will also live with him. We know that Christ, being raised from the dead, will never die again. Death no longer has dominion over him. The death he died to sin once for all. But the life he lives to God. So you also must consider yourselves dead to sin and alive to God in Christ Jesus. This is the word of the Lord.
The Gospel is written in the 20th chapter of the Gospel according to St John, beginning at the first verse.
Glory be to you, Lord.
Early on the first day of the week, while it was still dark, Mary Magdalene came to the tomb and saw that the stone had been removed from the tomb. So she ran and went to Simon Peter and the other disciple, the one whom Jesus loved, and said to them, "They have taken the Lord out of the tomb, and we do not know where they have laid him." Then Peter and the other disciples set out and went towards the tomb. The two were running together, but the other disciple outran Peter and reached the tomb first. He bent down to look in and saw the linen wrappings lying there, but he did not go in. Then Simon Peter came, following him, and went into the tomb. He saw the linen wrappings lying there, and the cloth that had been on Jesus' head, not lying with the linen wrappings, but rolled up in a place by itself. Then the other disciple who reached the tomb first also went in, and he saw and believed. For as yet they did not understand Scripture, that he must rise from the dead. Then the disciples returned to their homes. But Mary stood weeping outside the tomb. As she wept, she bent over to look into the tomb, and she saw two angels in white, sitting where the body of Jesus had been lying, one at the head and the other at the feet. They said to her, "Woman, why are you weeping?" She said to them, "They have taken away my Lord, and I do not know where they have laid him." When she had said this, she turned round and saw Jesus standing there, but she did not know that it was Jesus. Jesus said to her, "Woman, why are you weeping? For whom are you looking?" Supposing him to be the gardener, she said to him, "Sir, if you have carried him away, tell me where you have laid him, and I will take him away." Jesus said to her, "Mary." She turned and said to him in Hebrew, "Rabboni," which means teacher. Jesus said to her, "Do not hold on to me, because I have not yet ascended to the Father. But go to my brothers and say to them, 'I am ascending to my Father and your Father, to my God and your God.'" Mary Magdalene went and announced to the disciples, "I have seen the Lord." And she told them that he had said these things to her. This is the Gospel of the Lord.
May I speak in the name of the living God, who is Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. Well, tonight and tomorrow, Christians celebrate for us the most seismic, transformative event in history. The event that is the reason for and the foundation of our faith. Yet there is no account of the actual event of the resurrection ever unknowable, ever our fundamental mystery. But we know that the tomb was empty. We know that disciples experienced the risen and transfigured spiritual body of Jesus. And we know that in response, the disciples were galvanized and created the church, which grew with quite staggering speed and conviction. Now, artistic and dramatic interpretation of the resurrection can only ever merely hint at aspects of the resurrection and its impact. Convincing depiction of the resurrected Jesus, who was initially not recognized by his friends and who appears and disappears, is a struggle for figurative artists as brilliant as Fra Angelico, whose painting graces the cover of the Order of Service, with Jesus holding an implement as a gardener, but doing an interesting sort of sachet around Mary Magdalene. The equally brilliant Piero della Francesca depicts Jesus stepping out of the tomb with the flag of resurrection, with the guards sleeping, on that in that wonderful wall painting in San Sepolcro. In music, even the peerless Johann Sebastian Bach's "Et Resurrexit," and the third day he rose again in the creed of his quite glorious B minor mass. "Et Resurrexit" is after a pause, and it is produced with an explosion of noise, which to me seems just a little hammy, really. It's not a crime to describe the Bach as hammy. I'm sure it is in Leipzig. And as the poet Malcolm Geit observes, the resurrection is a reality that always eludes the net of words with which we try to catch it. We can all, artists or otherwise, but strive to show flashes that point to its significance, to its transformative power, as our eyebrow singeing fire created by Lee at the start of the service was designed to do. A quite beautiful story of Mary Magdalene's encounter in the garden depicts the transformation from darkness to hope. And gardens, with their celebrations of the wonder, some of the wonders of creation, are the context for several key events in the Bible: the expulsion from the Garden of Eden, the agony of Jesus in the Garden of Gethsemane, his betrayal in the garden, and here the ecstatic encounter of Mary with Jesus. Jesus, who is the gardener of the Garden of Eden. The men return home, but Mary, in her grief and devotion, chooses to stay. Throughout the Gospels, the women are the ones to stay close to Jesus. The shattering experience of loss, exacerbated by the disappearance of the body, is transformed into unfettered and unexpected joy, with a frisson of fear, no doubt. Mary's life is flooded with light. She's commissioned by Jesus to broadcast the news, to be the apostle to the apostles. The resurrection does not mean, however, that we forget Good Friday. The resurrection is inextricably linked to the crucifixion. No Good Friday, no resurrection. The crucifixion shows the depths of God's love. The resurrection, the power of his victory over darkness, and the basis of our hope. Not hope as we generally use the word. I hoped that Newcastle would batter West Ham. Lee hoped that West Ham would batter Newcastle today. Watch it on Match of the Day. I may hope to find some fabulous shoes in TK Maxx. But Christian hope is certain, based on the promises and actions of God and accessed by faith. We have certain hope in the resurrection to full life. The crucifixion, though, is the basis for our assurance that God identifies with us as we experience darkness. We are constantly reminded of the bewildering randomness of darkness and how so much of this life seems to be a lottery. The appalling suffering of the people of Gaza, with sickeningly and outrageously the women and children bearing the brunt, the men working on the bridge in Baltimore suddenly destroyed by the out of control ship. Loved ones suddenly being stricken by disease. And the presence of evil or darkness deters many from a belief in a loving God, as articulated a few years ago by Stephen Fry, who railed against God as a monstrous, capricious maniac because he doesn't eradicate cancer, other diseases. Now, as Christians, we don't have a neat, convincing answer for why there is evil and darkness in God's creation. It is in part due to the ramifications of each of us having free will and often misusing it. We don't have an answer for the evil that appears in other parts of creation, but we do know that God, who is light and love, did not create evil, which is a turning from his light. And we do know that in Jesus Christ, God draws alongside us, chose to suffer the full force of darkness on Good Friday. When the former Bishop of London, Richard Charters, was asked, "Where was God on 9/11? Simply replied, "Being crucified." But death does not have the last word. Its sting is removed. From the deepest darkness, hope bursts forth. As we suffer darkness and ultimately death, we know that beyond there is light and perfection. But in this world, as the World War I chaplain Woodbine Willie, formerly a priest up the road, observed as he reflected on the horrors of the Western Front, God does not always get his own way in the midst of the randomness of evil, but he sees things through. He endures to the end. When we are in darkness, God may not immediately turn on the light as we would like. We know that he is with us in the darkness. God created us out of unconditional love for relationship, a relationship he wants to be eternal with each of us. And as we do our best with our limitations to celebrate the resurrection and point to its incomprehensibly multi-dimensional colour and joy, we must also remember the quietness and the low-key nature of the appearances that Jesus chose to make to his friends. There is no triumphant display of power in the temple in front of the authorities who condemned him. In the wonderful varied accounts of the resurrection appearances, with differing details that compound their validity as testimony, Jesus draws alongside his friends to demonstrate his new life, the new life that they could look forward to, the new life that we look forward to. He calls us in the same way to point to this life by drawing alongside, by being involved as agents of transforming hope in the darkness. May we allow the joy of the resurrection to keep boiling over within us. May we be living evidence of the resurrection. And to close, some words from the Tudor poet Edmund Spenser. "Most glorious Lord of life, that on this day didst make thy triumph over death and sin, and having harrowed hell didst bring away captivity, thence captive us to win. This joyous day, dear Lord, with joy begin, and grant that we for whom thou didst die, being with thy dear blood clean washed from sin, may live forever in felicity." In the name of Jesus, amen. Let your light so shine before men that they may see your good works and glorify your Father which is in heaven.
Thank you.
Ye that do truly and earnestly repent of your sins and are in love and charity with your neighbours and intend to lead a new life, following the commandments of God and walking from henceforth in his holy ways, draw near with faith and take this holy sacrament to your comfort and make your humble confession to Almighty God. Almighty God, Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, maker of all things, judge of all men, we acknowledge and bewail our manifold sins and wickedness, which we from time to time most grievously have committed, by thought, word, and deed, against thy divine majesty, provoking most justly thy wrath and indignation against us. We do earnestly repent, and are heartily sorry for these our misdoings. The remembrance of them is grievous unto us. The burden of them is intolerable. Have mercy upon us. Have mercy upon us, most merciful Father, for thy Son, our Lord Jesus Christ's sake. Forgive us all that is past, and grant that we may ever hereafter serve and please thee in newness of life, to the honour and glory of thy name, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, who of his great mercy hath promised forgiveness of sins to all them that with hearty repentance and true faith turn unto him, have mercy upon you, pardon, and deliver you from all your sins, confirm and strengthen you in all goodness, and bring you to everlasting life through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks unto our Lord God. It is very meet, right, and our bounden duty that we should at all times and in all places give thanks unto thee, O Lord, Holy Father, Almighty, Everlasting God. But chiefly are we bound to praise thee for the glorious resurrection of thy Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. For he is the very Paschal Lamb, which was offered for us and hath taken away the sin of the world, who by his death hath destroyed death, and by his rising to life again hath restored to us everlasting life. Therefore, with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, we laud and magnify thy glorious name, evermore praising thee and singing.
Thank you.
Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, who of thy tender mercy didst give thine only Son, Jesus Christ, to suffer death upon the cross for our redemption, who made there, by his one oblation of himself once offered, a full, perfect, and sufficient sacrifice, oblation, and satisfaction for the sins of the whole world, and did institute, and in his holy gospel command us to continue a perpetual memory of that his precious death until his coming again. Hear us, O merciful Father, we most humbly beseech thee, and grant that we, receiving these thy creatures of bread and wine, according to thy Son, our Saviour Jesus Christ's holy institution, in remembrance of his death and passion, may be partakers of his most blessed body and blood. In the same night that he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Likewise, after supper, he took the cup, and when he'd given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "Drink ye all of this, for this is my blood of the New Testament, which is shed for you and for many for the remission of sins. Do this as oft as ye shall drink it, in remembrance of me." Here we offer and present unto thee, O Lord, ourselves, our souls and bodies, to be a reasonable, holy, and lively sacrifice unto thee, humbly beseeching thee that all we who are partakers of this holy communion may be fulfilled with thy grace and heavenly benediction, through Jesus Christ our Lord, by whom and with whom, in the unity of the Holy Ghost, all honour and glory be unto thee, O Father Almighty, world without end. Amen. Now, as our Saviour Christ hath commanded and taught us, we are bold to say, Our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, in earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive them that trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Draw near and receive the body of our Lord Jesus Christ, which was given for you, and his blood, which was shed for you. Take them in remembrance that Christ died for you, and feed on him in your hearts by faith, with thanksgiving. Almighty and ever-living God, we most heartily thank thee for that thou dost vouchsafe to feed us who duly receive these holy mysteries with the spiritual food of the most precious body and blood of thy Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ, and dost assure us thereby of thy favour and goodness towards us, and that we are very members incorporate in the mystical body of thy Son, which is the blessed company of all faithful people, and are also heirs through hope of thy everlasting kingdom, by the merits of the most precious death and passion of thy dear Son. And we most humbly beseech thee, O Heavenly Father, so to assist us with thy grace, that we may continue in that holy fellowship, and do all such good works as thou hast prepared for us to walk in. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord, to whom with thee and the Holy Ghost be all honour and glory, world without end. Amen. Well, many thanks to all of you for joining us for our first celebration of Easter. It's been a joy to worship with you, and do return to St Stephen Walbrook when you can, and have a most blessed, joyful Easter, and do stay behind for refreshments if you're able. The peace of God, which passeth all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of his Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost be amongst you and remain with you always. Amen.